This is the first of a series of videos on the Pacific Theater in GMT's World War II strategy game, A World at War. If you enjoy this video and want to see more like it, be sure to click the subscribe button to indicate your support. National perspectives vary on exactly when World War II started. Europeans would pick 1939. Chinese are likely to choose 1931, while Japanese would select 1937. But for Americans, we can be exact to the minute. Japan's strategy in World War II was very logical. Japan wanted to create an economically self-sufficient empire in Asia, so it would conquer Southeast Asia, presenting the United States with a fait accompli. Then it would just wait for the U.S. to accept the inevitable and negotiate. Since Britain and France couldn't offer serious resistance, the only potential obstacle in Japan's path was the U.S. Pacific Fleet, so it would be knocked out of action at the very start of the war. The problem was, the plan had a catch-22 built into it. If the U.S. wasn't attacked and the Pacific Fleet was intact, the U.S. wouldn't accept Japanese domination of Asia. But if the U.S. was attacked, especially by surprise, it would be so angry it would never negotiate. In planning this strategy, Yamamoto was under no illusions as to America's war potential, although other Japanese leaders may have been. But in hoping to collapse the morale of the United States by inflicting a massive blow on the Pacific Fleet on the first day of the war, he misjudged the character of the American people and government. Let's look at the Japanese initial attack as it is conducted in a world at war. While the course of the war will always vary, the basic Japanese attack is generally the same, unless storm over Asia has been played first. The Japanese attack plan was certainly ambitious, as in the first 6 months of the war, Japan would attack a wide range of targets. The Philippines, Malaya and Singapore, Borneo, the Dutch East Indies, Burma, Guam, the South Pacific and New Guinea, and, as the essential precondition to all of these, Pearl Harbor. This video will focus on the Pearl Harbor attack and won't deal with the other Japanese operations. The three pages of Rule 51 will be consulted in every game, even by experienced players. They aren't that complicated, but there's no point in memorizing rules that come into play only once per game. The composition of the Japanese strike force that may attack Pearl Harbor is governed by Rule 51.12. The Japanese task force may contain any number of 3 or 4-factor fast carriers, at least 2 battlecruisers, and 1 cruiser. The Japanese strike force normally contains 6 3-factor carriers. If the Pearl Harbor attack is delayed until 1942 in a classic A World at War game, Japan could have a 7th carrier. Storm over Asia may allow Japan to have a 7th or even an 8th carrier for a 1941 attack. In this video, we will use the historical Japanese force, which consisted of the following ships. 6 carriers, Akagi, Kaga, Hiryu, Soryu, Shokaku, and Zukaku. 2 battlecruisers, Hai and Kirishima. 2 cruisers, Tone and Chikuma. The U.S. Pacific Fleet consists of 3 fast carriers, 8 slow battleships, 7 2-factor cruisers, and 12 destroyers. The Pacific Fleet can be reinforced, at the American player's option, with additional ships launched once a world at war has started. As we will see, there are advantages and disadvantages to sending additional carriers to the Pacific. The carrier battles to come were foreseen only by a handful of air enthusiasts. Both sides considered the heart of the Pacific Fleet to be the 8 American battleships. Arizona, California, Maryland, Nevada, Oklahoma, Pennsylvania, Tennessee, and West Virginia. Each Pacific Fleet carrier must be placed in a 10-factor task force. The ships needed to escort these carriers come from newly launched 4-factor battleships, cruisers and destroyers that start in the Pacific Fleet, and additional cruisers and destroyers built in either the Atlantic or Pacific. We will assume that one carrier has been transferred to the Pacific Fleet, giving it a total of 4 carriers organized in Task Forces 1 to 4 as follows. Task Force 1, Enterprise. Task Force 2, Lexington. Task Force 3, Saratoga. And Task Force 4, Hornet. The American battleships and remaining light ships are placed in Task Forces 5 and 6. Before Japan attacks, the location of the American carriers is determined by rolling on the Pearl Harbor surprise table. We will use the 34 to 35 column, which is probably the most common one for Pearl Harbor attacks. The carrier location rolls are made by the American player, so the whereabouts of the Enterprise, Lexington, and Saratoga remain a worrisome mystery to the Japanese. But the Hornet is at Pearl Harbor, and will be a prime target for the attacking Japanese naval air units. No American counterattack against the Japanese strike force is possible, so all 18 Japanese naval air squadrons will attack. Japan gained several important advantages from achieving surprise in its initial attack at Pearl Harbor. All Japanese air attack dice rolls receive a +1 modifier. This is in addition to a likely +1 modifier for Japan's elite naval air having a higher air nationality DRM than the American air and naval DRMs. There is no American air defense roll, and damage results on ships trigger a critical hit roll. As we look at the naval attack table, keep in mind that Japan gets a +2 modifier for its air attack rolls, and this is increased to +4 against the Hornet, which is particularly vulnerable, and the American air units are attacked as though they were ships. It is important for Japan to knock out the American air, both to save naval air units in the first round of attacks, but also, more importantly, to weaken Pearl Harbor's defenses for a second attack. 7 Japanese naval air squadrons are committed to attacking the American air. 3 hits are needed to eliminate the 3 American Army air factors, so Japan needs to attack with 5 naval air squadrons, which eliminate all 3 American Army air factors on anything but a roll of 2. To eliminate the 3 American naval air squadrons, which count as 1 factor, Japan needs 2 naval air squadrons for a sure win. That leaves 11 naval air squadrons to attack the Pacific Fleet itself. 4 Japanese naval air squadrons all but guarantee the destruction of the Hornet. If it survives, the Japanese can try to finish it off in their second attack. Now Japan has 7 naval air squadrons remaining. What should they attack? Some players would hit the American light ships, but it's hard to resist going after some of the American battleships. The Japanese player has a choice between attacking 2 battleships with 4 and 3 naval air squadrons, or spreading the attack out among 3 battleships. Let's be greedy and attack the Arizona with 3 naval air and the California and Maryland with 2 naval air each. Each Japanese attack is resolved by rolling 2 dice on the appropriate row of the naval attack table. The 5 naval air squadrons attacking the 3 American Army air roll a 3, modified to a 5, for 3 hits, which is just good enough. We know the 3 American naval air squadrons are doomed, but we'll roll just for fun. The Japanese waste a 9, modified to an 11, for an overkill of 3 hits. 4 Japanese naval air squadrons attack the Hornet. They roll an 8, modified to a maximum result of 12, for 5 hits, which sinks the Hornet in port and triggers a critical hit roll, which we will come back to in a minute. Next come the Japanese attacks on the American battleships. The Arizona is attacked by three Japanese naval air squadrons. They roll a 6, modified to an 8, for 2 hits, which damages the Arizona and triggers another critical hit roll. The California is attacked by only 2 Japanese naval air squadrons. They roll a 3, modified to a 5, for just 1 hit. This attack failed, and the hit is removed at the end of the combat round. In the final attack of the first round, the 2 Japanese naval air squadrons attacking the Maryland roll a 6, modified to an 8, for 2 hits. This damages the Maryland and triggers a third critical hit roll. Critical hits are rolled for named ships in several situations. The 2 that are relevant to our example are ships sunk in port and ships damaged when a maximum +7 surprise level applies. A critical hit occurs if a single die roll equals or exceeds the size of the ship. Excess hits on a ship sunk in port modify the critical hit die roll and make a critical hit more likely. All these rules are found in the same place, Rule 20.524. Critical hits bump the damage level of a ship to the next level. Undamaged ships are damaged, damaged ships are sunk, and ships sunk in port are destroyed. Returning to our example, the Hornet will incur a critical hit on any die roll because of the +2 modifier from excess hits. The Hornet explodes and is destroyed. The Arizona will incur a critical hit on a die roll of 3. Japan rolls a 5, and the Arizona is sunk in port. The Maryland will also incur a critical hit on a die roll of 3. Japan rolls a 6, so the Maryland is sunk in port as well. Japan can be satisfied with destroying an American carrier and sinking 2 American battleships. But should it be? The Japanese player must ask, should I stay or should I go? Historically, Vice Admiral Nagumo chose to go. Nagumo was worried about the American carriers, which weren't in Pearl Harbor. Our Japanese player also has to wonder where the Enterprise, Lexington, and Saratoga might be. If the American carriers find the Japanese strike force, an abbreviated naval battle occurs. The Americans launch an airstrike on the Japanese. The Japanese can't attack the Americans. The U.S. makes a surprise roll for its airstrike. And the battle then ends with no further combat. This procedure is set out in Rule 52.43. As with most of the Pearl Harbor rules, it isn't worth memorizing, but you do want to know the rule exists. It's the American surprise role that makes their carriers frightening. The surprise could be mild, or Midway might come early. In the worst-case scenario, Japan's combat air patrol would be bypassed, the Japanese air defense level would be reduced by 1, and the American attack rolls would have a +1 modifier. Because there is no modifier for the surprise roll, Japan at least doesn't have to worry about a 7 result, which would mean damage results against named ships would trigger a critical hit roll. The Nagumo in our example launches a second strike, while hedging his bet by holding back 4 naval air squadrons for defense. Because the Americans are now on full alert, this attack will be a fight. There is no American air to worry about, but the Japanese do have to get through the air defenses of Pearl Harbor. We go to the air defense table to determine the air defense level of Pearl Harbor. +4 for 31 naval factors in Pearl Harbor, +2 for Oahu, which is a port, +2 for Pearl Harbor, which is also a port, and +1 for Pearl Harbor, which is an objective. This gives a total air defense of 9, unless the Western Allies have an air defense research result. The air defense dice roll is 9 for a 3/2 result. 3 Japanese naval air squadrons are eliminated, and another 2 are forced to abort their attack. 9 Japanese naval air squadrons attack. Japan must choose one or more of the following 3 targets: the remaining American battleships, the American light ships, and the Pearl Harbor oil reserve. There are arguments to be made in favor of all of these, but the Japanese go for the American light ships. Japan's 9 naval air squadrons roll a 5, modified to a 6, for 5 hits. These hits are applied according to Rule 20.551. The first 2 hits sink a cruiser, the next 2 hits sink 2 destroyers, and the last hit damages another cruiser. The Japanese player can be fairly happy with the results of the attack, having destroyed about 40 BRPs of naval units, including one carrier. Now the Japanese hope to escape without being found by any of the American carriers, but the Japanese hopes are shattered. Beating the odds, the American interception rolls are a 4 and 2 sixes, and all 3 American carriers are able to attack. The Japanese luck improves when the Americans only roll a 2 for surprise. This has 2 effects. The Japanese combat air patrol doesn't get its usual +1 air combat modifier, and the Japanese air defense level is reduced by 1. The Japanese player won't complain, though. It could have been a lot worse. The American air now has to fight its way through the Japanese defenses. First, there is air combat with the Japanese combat air patrol, with both sides using 4 naval air squadrons. Japan has a +1 modifier, but only rolls a 4, modified to a 5, for a 1/2 result. Japan loses a naval air squadron, which isn't very important. The Japanese results are what matters. One attacking American naval air squadron is eliminated, and 2 others abort their attack. This leaves 6 American naval air squadrons to continue their attack. Japan still has an air defense role, although at a lower level because of the surprise effects. But Japan rolls boxcars, which almost certainly saves at least 1 Japanese carrier. The Japanese anti-aircraft guns turn out to be more effective than their fighters. 2 American naval air squadrons are eliminated and another aborts. Only 3 American naval air squadrons get through to the Japanese ships. The modifier for the American air attacks against Japanese carriers is +2, +1 for the American nationality DRM advantage, and +1 for naval air attacking ships at sea. In deciding how to attack the Japanese carriers, the American player looks at both the minimum and expected results of attacking with 1, 2, and 3 naval air squadrons. With 1 naval air squadron, the Americans need a 9 dice roll to damage a Japanese carrier. With 2 naval air squadrons, the Americans need only a 6 dice roll to damage a Japanese carrier, and a 9 to sink one. Since attacking a second carrier with 1 naval air squadron isn't likely to accomplish anything, the American player decides to concentrate all 3 naval air squadrons in a single attack. It can be ugly when theory runs into reality. After all they've gone through, the Americans crap out on their attack roll and miss. The American interception actually backfired, as the U.S. lost more naval air squadrons than the Japanese. In terms of the overall result, the Japanese should be very happy. The most important thing to take away from this video is that almost anything can happen in naval combat. But we also saw the forces involved in the Pearl Harbor operation, how Japan resolves its initial attack, the decision to stay for a second attack, and how airstrikes are resolved.
Outside the barracks, by the corner light, I'll always always stand and wait for you at night. We will create a world for two. I wait for you the whole night through. For you, Lily Moore.